As Lynn mentioned, I'm Bill. I head up the digital building practice. If people are familiar with CISCO, you probably think of CISCO really in the IT space. The idea that CISCO is in the buildings construction space is a little bit foreign. And so what I'm going to take you through in the next 30 minutes is just some overview on some trends, some personal thoughts, and really what I'd like you to do is really focus on the two words in the beginning here is leave with the concept of space and the other concept of platforms. And both space and platforms have actually been a bit of a thread through the earlier presentations this morning. So if you think about a little bit about my journey, we all have a journey on why we're here today is my journey actually started with a thermostat. I said to my parents, I was going to go to Queens, I'm going to learn how to sell thermostats, and they went like, really? That's really so disappointing. But if you think about what's actually happening with the thermostat, think of it as an edge device, an IoT device, is quite telling what's occurring, which actually rolls back into design and construction. So the thermostat itself, it starts getting more compute power, it's more controllable, and if anyone has a Nest thermostat at home, it's now IP-enabled, talks to the cloud, and it knows what your family's doing, right? Or it's perceived what it knows what your family's doing. And so this idea of edge devices is fascinating to our business practice. The other thing that's very, very important to us is the whole idea of architecture. So if anyone have followed Frank Lloyd Wright, gone to Taliesin or Taliesin West, or even in fact visited Falling Water in Pennsylvania, this is a home that he designed in, he indicates less than 4 hours. Now he didn't build it in 4 hours, but there's a lot of interesting technology that went into this building. But all this technology was there specific to drive some type of an experience in space, right? And we literally take this to heart at CISCO. So I'm gonna just kind of go on the theme a bit of experience right now. This is a cabin that my dad built when he was 17. And he said to my sisters and my mom, come to the cabin for an awesome experience. And we say, you gotta be kidding me. It was a horrible time there. No running water, no electricity. We hated it. So about 3 years ago, Lynn and I decided to put a team together. And the team had architects, it had engineers. We worked with a company called Bone Structure out of Montreal. Bit of BIM going on here, a little bit of 3D modeling. We took the design out of Phoenix, Arizona, and we decided that we were gonna build a new little cabin that was a kit of parts. And the kit of parts was really modeled around using a BIM platform, plus or minus a couple of millimeters in accuracy, and it came on a truck. And then from the truck, they boomed it into the site, and you can see what's kind of going on here. And they had a crane, and within 2.5 days, they actually put this thing up. And you can see us running around the site. The chap in the white hair is Michael. He just turned 80. He's our architect out of Phoenix. And the reason we did this was for a variety of reasons. Number one is we wanted to drive the speed of the project. We wanted quality of the project. And you can see that the building is sitting up on some stilts there. After we did some earthquake analysis, we wanted to transfer the risk of the structural integrity the Bone Structure. And we did that all through this collaborative process. So one of your homework assignments is if you happen to get into the Ottawa area and you're 21 kilometers north of Ottawa in Val-de-Mont, I'll put the barbecue on, okay? And what we'll do is we'll actually experience what our end goal was. And the end goal of that building was to bring nature into the building. And so everybody here is in the design and construction business, so we are adamant about focus on space to deliver experience for end tenant. Right, so that's critical. Now, the other thing what we do at CISCO is we look at adjacent businesses that are expanding. You can see commercial automation, lighting, robots, the whole AI business, and all these adjacent businesses that are focused around Internet of Things and big data are actually having impact on design, construct, operate, and experience. So we're constantly looking at what's going on around us. When we look at customers that we've worked at in the past, they have taken to heart the concept of space and platforms. And so here's a fun project in Ottawa, Bank of Canada. In Toronto, we are blessed with shiny tall buildings, so we had a chance to work with Oxford Properties on 100 Adelaide. If you get onto waterfront, you'll see George Brown College, which is again going through a new expansion program with a tall wood building, which will be quite fascinating. You go slightly east of George Brown, there's Sidewalk Labs, which will be very, very fascinating, and especially in the area of data and data privacy, so another group that's fun to work with. The one project that is happening outside of our window at the office is CIBC Square. And I put that up for the fact that if you're going to have a successful dynamic project, you need to bring all the stakeholders together early, architects, engineers, constructors. You can see the Ellis Don is leading it from a construction point of view, TMP's mechanical, Mulvey's on the electrical side, but what's very, very interesting is certifications that are starting to show up. And so if you understand what the certs are that will be turned on with the building, whether it's LEED or WELL or Wired Score, you can take that end goal and roll it back maybe into BIM, right? So there is some threading going on here. Now, we do some specialty projects. So when you do come to the office, we'll do a photo op with Wilbur. And the reason we have Wilbur in the office is because everybody here, whether you admit it or not, we love bacon, or back bacon. We really do. And so one part of CISCO's business is in factory floor automation in the pork industry. So anyways, Wilbur was a hit yesterday, most definitely. Now, to platforms, which is quite fascinating, everything around us, including in buildings, is a platform. This is going to be the new Union Station. Just kidding, it's not going to look like that, but we're all familiar with platforms from a train perspective. Did you know, though, that if you buy a Volvo, the new XC40, you're not buying a car, you're actually buying a lifestyle platform, and you're buying a platform that's tied into Amazon. And what Amazon's done is they've got a relationship set up, so if they would like to deliver a package to you, they'll deliver it to the boot of your car securely. Right, so very fascinating how companies are lining up. If you don't like checkout lines in supermarkets, watch what's happening with Amazon, picks up Whole Foods. In Seattle, there's Amazon Go, where every piece of lettuce and juice and granola bars are all IoT sensorized. I move into the space, I pick up the devices, it loads up my bill, I walk out. There's no friction with cashiers. So again, a platform delivery. We're doing a lot of work in lighting, and I'll kind of roll back to that, but lighting also is a platform, a data platform. When we first sit down with customers, we ask them a number of key questions. We ask them why they got out of bed in the morning. That's kind of a fun one. If they had a silver bullet for their business, what possibly could it be? But the recurring theme is more and more customers have problems that they like to solve. Technology is an enabler. And if you determine what the solution is, over time, what you want to do is you want to tie business metrics, key performance indicators to that solution to continually validate that you're on track. We do a lot of that also. We also, when we sit down in, you know, the building of buildings, we go through the five pillars. Could I build it less expensively? Will it use less energy? Could Could I make it secure? Now, the big security point these days is, if all these systems are connected, will I get hacked? It's not whether you're going to get hacked. You probably have been hacked. So the idea of cybersecurity and data privacy is big from our standpoint. And then when we think about space, is could we actually utilize our space more? Could we have more people in smaller space? Hoteling, huddle rooms. Maybe you don't come to the office, you just work out of Starbucks. So utilization and compression is starting to change shape of the buildings themselves. And then the fundamental question is, why should I show up at that office? Why should I go to that school or library or airport? And so experience is really the end goal of everything that we're working on. You talked a little bit about disruption. I recommend everybody, if you haven't read this book, it's been out for a long time. Any book readers, Who Moved My Cheese? People that don't know the book, is quite interesting. It's got color pictures in it. It's got a couple of mice. They get up in the morning and they go to where their cheese is. And then one day somebody moved it, actually just moved it around the corner. And the one mouse gets very, very fearful. Oh my God, my cheese is gone. I don't think I can find my cheese anymore. And the other mouse says, come on, let's go out and explore for more cheese. And that second mouse is extremely successful. The first one starts trending down, right? So right now, everyone in the room here, you're moving people's cheese. And so we want to, you know, make sure that we're dead on that. In terms of real estate that we focus on, and real estate from a building's perspective is really a Lego block. A building is a Lego block to, say, a campus, to a neighborhood, to a city, to a province, to a country. And whether it's in building or across a country, these are fundamental trends that are impacting how we design, construct, and experience buildings. So the idea of mobility, we're moving through buildings, we're moving across cities. A video, we're turning video on to communicate. Everybody loves the whole concept of having some type of app. Well, actually, the apps are going away and they're being replaced by gesturing, integration gesturing with systems. Or maybe I use voice to command. Right, so that's setting up some interesting interactions between us and buildings, us and cities. I love Internet of Things. I have it for breakfast, generally speaking. And why I like it is it directly impacts design and construction. So sensing everywhere, on us, maybe not in us, but on us, in cars, at home, in the carpet, drywall, concrete, it's everywhere. The other thing is every inanimate object's gonna become smart. Smart garbage can, I'm on fire. IP-enabled toilets. Now we're gonna leave that one out of the discussion, but everything happening in the bathroom is becoming IP-enabled. I guess it's a better experience. I don't know. We won't go there, but everything's becoming smart. Furniture's smart. Love Herman Miller furniture. You know, desk is talking to the chair. Desk vibrates after I've been sitting there for 30 minutes, walk around, feel good. If you take a look at the skins of buildings, they're starting to become dynamic. This is actually a product called View Glass. It changes opacity based on sun angle, time of year, occupancy. Sets up some very interesting energy management, cooling load capabilities. And then I'm not sure if people on the weekend wire up electrical switches, any sort of weekend electrical warriors here, a couple. Yeah, the on-offs are easy. Dimmers are okay. Three-ways, I just can't get the three-ways. But I have a friend of mine in Thunder Bay, Ian, and he's an electrician, and he loves installing light switches for about $300 a pop. So I'm on Thunder. I'm up in on Lake Superior this summer having a beer. I said, Ian, how's business? Bonus business. Oh, okay. Did you know that the light switch is going away? So what? And I pull up my phone, and it's going to become a mobile app. And then he said, well, that's not going good for me, is it? I said, no, it's bad. So there's always been that rivalry, you know, since grade seven. But watch how things go from physical to sort of a virtual side. If you're into buildings, you probably realize that you have to have real estate and IT at the world at the same table. We're doing a lot of work understanding how building systems, whether it's lighting or elevators or HVAC, that have been disparate in the past are collapsing. The collapse is occurring because everything's IP enabled. They're smart. They want to share data. If anyone's in the AC business, right, our friend the AC, everything's starting to go DC powered. Right, low voltage, DC powered. Quite interesting. Because Cisco's been involved in the IT world, IT has been using computer cables forever and a day to provide power and communication. So if you take that old RJ45 and plug her in, we can start delivering power. Now up to 60 watts and soon 100 watts. And what that's starting to do is take all the subsystems in your building, phones, cameras, light bulbs, thermostats, mechanical equipment, and that's all starting to move off of AC power onto DC infrastructure, which is really moving people's cheese for sure. We call it actually the fourth utility or the converged network. So if you're designing a building, of course, you're going to have the right amount of gas and water and electricity services to last maybe 30 years for the project. We're now claiming that you should spend time on IT infrastructure and get that right and future-proof it as the fourth utility. And so yesterday I was able to, I hosted a bunch of delegates. We had a great time, walked around, all sorts of questions, walked around Water Park Place. Cisco was, we were very blessed with having the opportunity to work very front-end loaded on core and shell. WZMH was architect of record. Triple M was the base building electrical consultant. Heedy was a mechanical consultant. Ellistone was a constructor. And we built this core and shell, and then Cisco made a decision that we were actually going to occupy three floors, which is our Canadian headquarters. And what was kind of interesting here is we then had a chance to work with HOK, which is our designer of record. And we did everything from, you know, how you name the rooms, fit and finish, furniture selection. But the one that I got totally embedded in was lighting, right? I love lighting. And what we actually did in the building is we decided to take a little bit of line voltage conduit and BX cabling out and popped in some computer cables. And on the computer cables, we connected to the base building building automation system. So if anyone is into BAS, this is actually a variable air volume controller, sits up in the ceiling space. You can see the little Cat6 cable, boop, pops in, a little disruptive, a lot of fun. So then we said, well, why don't we just take the light bulbs? Now, that was just a kind of a bad day for a couple of people in the room. Electrically, we were moving from line voltage to low voltage, and we were kind of moving cheese around the, you know, the old boardroom. But what we did here is we worked with Philips, who had just come out with a very interesting lighting platform out of Eindhoven that sits on DC power. And then we kind of spruced up the IT closets, which are delivering some more power. And then spent a bunch of time around space planning, on hoteling, huddle rooms, reflected ceiling plans. And the whole concept, again, is space and every system in the building is a platform. So now what we're doing is we're starting to mine data out of different platforms. So the lighting system itself, not only does it give us light, but it also gives us temp, occupancy data, light level. So we take that information. If you were to come into our building and turn on Wi-Fi, we can actually triangulate your device down to less than 1 meter. We don't know who you are, but we just know the device is in the space. So if I took some data from the light bulbs and some data from my Wi-Fi network and I blended it, what we're actually doing is we're starting to dynamically adjust airflow patterns. So put air where people are, right? So this is having a big effect on wellness and also on energy and carbon footprint and all that. So the idea of data across platforms is really quite exciting. The other thing that's exciting is if you get the plumbing right, and if everything's smart, what you can do as time goes on, you can start turning on some pretty cool applications. So if you're in an office environment, what would be one of your pet peeves? Like, what are the things that really bug you about your office? Right? Not a skill testing question here. It's any takers on that? What really bothers you?
Temperature,
number one. Too hot, too cold. Everyone's fighting over the thermostat. I'm not sure who controls your thermostat at home, but Lynn will say, you touch that thermostat one more time, go into the woodshed, right? So we don't want that to happen. So you'll notice there's an application on the left side. It's called Comfy. Oxford came to us and they said, hey, there's this really cool mobile app. It's called Comfy. Put it on the phone. All Cisco employees did. And what we were able to do as an organization is we could vote democratically on temperature. Imagine that. Right? So we're voting. The voting goes to the cloud, turns around, comes down to the thermostat. And the end result, or the results to date, have been we are saving about 14% mechanical energy. And we're actually, they claim we're about 32% happier. And I'm not sure about the happy index. But anyways, we got some control. So you're going to see a massive input of new applications that are mining data across your platforms. They're going to do something in the cloud or at the fog. We had a little fog this morning, but in the cloud, and then it's going to drive the performance of how we interact with space and feel about space. So pretty darn exciting stuff. The other thing that's a common theme, especially in the commercial market space, and you can see what's going on in the tier one financials. You've got CIBC moving to CIBC Square. You have BMO looking at a very interesting innovation urban campus up in at the Eaton Center. Everyone that we talk to wants to provide the employee with a better experience, and they want to provide it from the standpoint that we're all trying to attract and retain. So this idea of connected spaces, mobility is kind of important. Kind of goes like this. I jump out of bed in the morning. I forgot to reserve a meeting room at the office. I decide I'm going to come into the office. So, you know, I log on. You know, I'm looking for some space. Found a room. And what I do now is, I wonder if this room has the right attributes. Does it have enough chairs, desk size, and that? Yep, like that one. Okay, good. Then I arrive at the office. Now, if I was new to that office, the building would welcome me. If I was new to that office and didn't know where I was actually going or where the room was actually booked, we get a little wayfinding happening here, right? So this is how we're going to move you through the building. Now, as I move through the building, of course, everyone's got lots of time between meetings, I'm sure. But if we're moving through the building, and you can see in this case, I've got 2 minutes ETA to the meeting, and I've got two choices that pop up on my path to the meeting. I can grab a coffee, or maybe I go to the restroom. If I'm really fast, I could do both. But you can see how the mobile app starts putting these virtual experiences on. And again, this is something that people are demanding. So now I rush into the office. I've decided to book this office. What I want to do, and I want to do it because I can do it at home, and I generally can't do it at the office, is I want to be able to adjust light levels. I want to be able to adjust color temperatures. I want to be able to adjust temperatures. I want to personalize the space for me. And I also, when I walk into the room, is I want any device that I'm going to interact with, it could be video or voice, I want it to turn on and be my device. So this is a huge, huge trend that we're working very hard with partners on. To do this, though, and it's quite telling is the fact that you got to get early. And BIM and these design platforms, we see them being injected into the project very early, at the strategy phase, at the time when maybe urban planning is happening, at the time when financing is happening. So what you don't want to do is get back-end loaded. You want to be at strategy, with the team, collaborate to define the value props for the project, go through the design, the RFP, the construct process, and then when you get into that operational phase, which say is could be 30 years in length, you future-proof the building to drive that performance across time. And so that's, in fact, what CISCO is doing is getting earlier and earlier in projects. If anyone in the room does spec writing, which is very, it's like watching paint dry, very, very dry, but very, very important. You know, we follow the National Master Specification. Everyone probably is involved in one of those divisions, from door hardware to fire alarm to automation. The section that we're spending a ton of time in is Division 27, which is IT infrastructure. We should call it the plumbing section, the IT plumbing section of the building. And that division is providing the connectivity, the secure data flow across platforms, so that when the projects do go to tender, the end customer knows that they're going to get what they're expecting. The other trend that we're seeing right now is the fact that if you're working with an owner and the owner has hired on an architect and they have the MEPs on board and then it goes to tender, the historical have general contractor subbing to mechanical and electrical and that's it, it's not working anymore. What is though working is there's a third contractor, a technology contractor, a master building integrator that is coming to the team to complement the M and the E. And what they're being held accountable for is actually connecting the data to drive the experience. So that's a growing piece. CISCO, we are the plumbers of the internet. We're one piece. We're one of the enabling pieces. We work with a large group of eco-partners. The combination is what drives the new value propositions. And one of the things that we've been able to do in Toronto is we have an innovation center. Some of the people had a chance to see it yesterday. What we're actually doing in the Innovation Center is we are one of nine globally. We are focused on smart cities, smart buildings, healthcare, retail, finance. And we have a lab, and in that lab there's different systems, both software and hardware. Wilbur's in that lab too, and what we're doing is getting together to solve business problems. So it's extremely collaborative. Love to work with everybody in the room here. And with that, I'll put the coffee on. Love to have you over. And I think as a group, we're ready to go. So thanks for your attention. Okay.